الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده سبحانه وتعالى حمد الشاكرين المعترفين بنعمائه العظيمة وآلائه الجسيمة اللهم لك الحمد يا ربنا كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك لك العتبى حتى ترضى ولا حول ولا قوة لنا إلا بك اللهم إنا يا ربنا نحمدك حمد العارفين ونحمدك يا ربنا حمد المخبتين ونحمدك يا ربنا حمد من رأى نعمك فشكرك عليها نحمدك يا ربنا حمدا كثيرا طيبا طاهرا دائما مباركا فيه ملء السماوات وملء الأرض وملء ما بينهما وملء ما شئت يا ربنا من شيء بعد أهل الثناء والمجد أحق ما قال العبد وكلنا لك عبد اللهم لا مانع لما أعطيت ولا معطي لما منعت ولا ينفع ذا الجد منك الجد وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في الله حق الجهاد حتى أتاه اليقين اللهم صلي وسلم وزد وبارك على الحبيب المصطفى محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأتباعه ومن اهتدى بهديه وعمل بسنته إلى يوم الدين وارض عنا معهم بفضلك وكرمك أرحم الراحمين اللهم آمين. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Endless He is in His glory, the creator of heavens and earth, the provider, the sustainer, the cherisher. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue to bless each and every one of us. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue to extend those blessings to those whom we love. I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship save Allah. And I bear witness that Muhammad is Allah's final prophet and messenger, the bearer of glad tidings, the role model to be followed. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May the peace and the blessings of Allah be upon him and his family, his companions, followers and students. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to extend those blessings to each and every one of us. Allahumma ameen. My dear brothers and sisters, I greet you with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. 1/3 of the month of Ramadan is already over. If you think of Ramadan as a treasure, half of it has already been spent. If you have won the lottery, even though participating in the lottery is not halal, but hypothetically, if you won the lottery, and you ask yourself now that 1/3 of that money has already been spent, did I squander the wealth and spent it on useless things, or has it been invested into something that will actually bring dividend in the future? This is what Ramadan is. Ramadan is wealth that needs to be invested and not wasted. Invested so that you can get that return in this dunya, and you get that return, inshallah ta'ala, in the hereafter as well. But 10 days of Ramadan are already gone. And as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us, some people will benefit and some people will lose in the month of Ramadan. Just this morning, when I prepare my khutbah, I usually go to a coffee shop away from home, away from the masjid, just so that I'm by myself. You know, sometimes you're surrounded with people, but you're still alone, right? In your own mind. So obviously I go to a coffee shop and actually they know me, so they know it's Ramadan and I don't drink coffee, I don't eat and drink in Ramadan. But I see Muslims going to that same coffee shop and order coffee. And they get their shortcake and they get their cookies and they eat that with coffee. And so sometimes we Muslims who come to the masjid, we live in our ivory towers thinking that all Muslims are observant and all Muslims, you know, observe Ramadan, observe that, you know, that is not true, right? But it is still the case that, alhamdulillah, most Muslims fast in the month of Ramadan. Even those who are not very religious, they fast in the month of Ramadan, and that is a blessing, right? And so I'm not talking about those who don't fast, even though I pity them and I feel very sorry for them. And sometimes when they see me, like, oh my God, the Imam just saw me right now. And they take their coffee and they go out, right? Or one of them in the parking lot is smoking and they see me park and they literally put out the cigarette and they go hide in their car until I disappear, right? It is not me that you need to worry about. It is not me that you need to worry about. It's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you need to worry about. It's your own spiritual survival that you need to worry about. It's missing the month of Ramadan that you need to worry about. I'm nothing. I'm not even important in that equation. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you need to be cognizant of, right? But the thing is, what I'm trying to say is that some people in the community may not even observe Ramadan whatsoever. Like every day in Ramadan is just like every other day of the year. It doesn't matter. It doesn't make any difference to them. Oh, today is the 15th of Ramadan. Oh my goodness, I didn't even know that Ramadan started. They don't care. Some people are like that, right? But then most Muslims, alhamdulillah, observe Ramadan and therefore they fast. And I ask them, did your fast make a difference in your life or not? Or is it just, you know, refraining from food and water and that's it? As the Prophet taught us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, رُبَّ صَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُوعُ وَالْعَطَشُ. You know, there are many people who fast in Ramadan. All they get from their fast is the pain of hunger and thirst. And that's all they get, right? The frustration, the pain, the sense of deprivation, you know, losing their temper, getting angry, being unproductive at work. That's all they get from the month of Ramadan. So I ask you, now that one third of Ramadan is already over, is that all you can say about Ramadan, that I've been hungry and thirsty? I mean, alhamdulillah, the weather has been great, right? So we're not thirsty, that's for sure. The day is still long, but we're not thirsty. Maybe a little bit hungry at the end of the day, but we're not exhausted. If this was 100 degree weather, we would have been so exhausted by the end of the day. So there's a blessing involved. But my question to you is, now that one third of Ramadan is over, are we saying that all we get from Ramadan is that we are hungry and thirsty, or is it something else? Or is there something else? And now that one third of the month is over, we need to make sure that we don't waste the two thirds that remain in the month of Ramadan. In Ramadan, brothers and sisters, there's so many blessings and there are endless, endless blessings. And In my opinion, I always feel like one of the most important blessings is to be able to press the reset button. You know, when you have a computer that has a lot of viruses and a lot of temporary files and the computer starts lagging on you, right? You don't know exactly what's wrong with it, but it's just slow and it's lagging and it's not performing as well anymore. And sometimes, you know, you try to uninstall some, you know, programs and some software or whatever, but it's still not fixing the problem. And sometimes the only solution is to do what? It's just format the hard drive and reinstall the operating system from scratch. Sometimes that's the only solution. It's the fastest solution, easiest solution. Ramadan provides you with an opportunity to press the reset button and to format the hard drive, and all your sins are wiped out, all your worries, all your concerns are gone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us in the ahadith, you know, through the words of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلِلَّهِ عُتَقَاءَ مِنَ النَّارِ فِي شَهْرِ رَمَضَانِ وَذَلِكَ كُلِّ لَيْلَةِ. Every night in Ramadan, there are some that will be saved, permanently saved from the fire of hell. Are you amongst them or not? Are you amongst them or not? Do you feel it in your heart? You know, sometimes you feel something in your stomach. You feel it in your bones. I feel that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgave me this month of Ramadan. I feel that my spirit grew this month of Ramadan. I am more connected. I am more bonding with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this month of Ramadan. You feel it right away, right? The blessings of forgiveness in Ramadan. The blessings of the Qur'an in Ramadan, brothers and sisters. Many of us don't even connect with the Qur'an throughout the year. But in Ramadan, you feel embarrassed. You know, what is wrong with me? I need to sit down at least 15 minutes before Maghrib and flip through the pages of the Qur'an. Maybe read, you know, one or two pages, or maybe a surah, or maybe one hizb, or maybe one juz of the Qur'an. Whatever you can get, right? You would develop a renewed connection with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is simply not available to many of us throughout the year, right? In the month of Ramadan, there is a renewed sense of connection to the masjid. Most Muslims, most observant Muslims come to the masjid on Fridays. But in Ramadan, we learn to come to the masjid every night. That is a big deal. That is a big deal for us with our busy schedules, with tomorrow morning we have work and the kids have school and all the obligations of life, and we develop that sense of connection with the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is a blessing. And people come to the masjid when they're not used to coming to the masjid, right? In the month of Ramadan, we develop a connection with each other. There is a renewed sense of community in the month of Ramadan through taraweeh, through the iftars, through the events and the gatherings and the tahajjud and the qiyam. And I get to know brothers and sisters that, inshallah, friendships and relationships that will last forever, right? There are so many blessings about Ramadan that drive me to say that it is safe to characterize the month of Ramadan as a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is safe to characterize Ramadan as a gift from Allah. You know, in the hadith, the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tahadu tahabu. Exchange gifts and presents with each other so that you may love each other. Okay? If you are, you know, just like going about your day and out of the blue, a friend of yours, you know, brings you a gift. And then, you know, the first question that you ask, what's the occasion? And then he's like, no, there's no occasion. It's been a while since I gave you a gift and I decided to give you a present, you know, out of love, you know. You're a good friend. And I cherish you in my life and I appreciate you in my life and I just wanted to give you this as a token of my love. How would you feel about that? I think your perception of that person will completely change. And that person suddenly, from being just a friend, will suddenly become like one of the highest, the top friends right there, right? Automatically. Because the Prophet ﷺ taught us, when we give presents to each other, we will develop an appreciation and a love for each other. And I want to tell you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you this gift consistently every year throughout your life. He grants you this gift every single year. And what I wanted to talk to you about today is, I want you to take advantage of the month of Ramadan and your perception of Ramadan as a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to develop a sense of love for Allah azza wa jal. And to nurture the love of Allah in your heart. And I know this is not easy. It's not easy for most of us. It is easy to obey God. It is easy to, you know, stay in line. It is easy to stay within the boundaries of God. But to love something that you have not seen is not easy. It's not easy on me. It's not easy on most of us, right? Obedience and following commands and orders, that's the easy part. But to feel the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your heart, it is not as easy. It requires effort. And that is why the Prophet ﷺ approximates the meaning in the hadith and he says, أَحِبُّ اللَّهَ لِمَا يَغْذُوكُمْ بِهِ مِنَ النِّعَمِ in the hadith. Love Allah for the abundance of blessings that He is constantly providing you with. Okay? So again, going back to the notion of gifts and presents. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you a present, you know, at least put Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that pedestal as you would, you know, a friend of yours when he gives you a present, okay? So if Ramadan is a present from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then take advantage of the month of Ramadan to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a result of those blessings, you know. So you say to yourself, you know, I am not committed that much to Islam. I'm not very religious. I don't even pray regularly. I barely make dua. I don't read the Quran. And, you know, I commit a lot of sins. And I'm not a good, perfect human being. But despite all that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives me the month of Ramadan and He says, if you stay in line, by the end of the month, I will wipe all of it out completely as if it never existed and you'll get a chance to start from scratch. All of your debts have been paid off. You know, when you're a student and you have a lot of student loans and you graduate college with $200,000 in loans, right? And you might go on for like 10 or 15 years paying it off. And you have to keep drawing from your monthly income to pay that off. What if somebody just came and said, you know what? You're a good person. You deserve a chance. I'm going to pay off all. I'm going to forgive your debt. Uncle Sam, the federal government will pitch in and forgive your entire debt. And suddenly, if you make $7,000 a month and you used to pay $3,000 of them in your student loans, suddenly you have all of it to yourself. How would you feel about that? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Ramadan tells you, all of your sins, all of your burdens, all the issues that used to bother you, and all these things that kept you away from me, I will remove them so that you don't have to worry about it anymore. What's there not to love about this? The Prophet says, أَحِبُّ اللَّهَ لِمَا يَغْذُوكُمْ بِهِ مِنَ النِّعَمِ. Love Allah for the abundance of blessings that He provides you with on a regular basis, right? And then He says, وَأَحِبُّونِي بحبكم لله. And love me as a result of your love for Allah. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam requests from us to love him. See, there's a lot of conversations about love in the deen that, you know, I wish we spend more time presenting and talking about, right? So love Allah for the blessings and love me for loving Allah. And then he says, وَأَحِبُّ آلَ بَيْتِ بِحُبِّي. And love my family as you love me, ya Allah. Isn't that a beautiful thing? Allah, the Prophet ﷺ tries to help you love Allah and love the Prophet and love the family of the Prophet ﷺ by walking you through this tiny little exercise. Love Allah because He provides you with a lot of blessings, Ramadan being one of them. And love me as a result of your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and love my family as you have loved me. That is the Prophet's request from us. And I wanted to make a comparison here, by the way. Take advantage of this moment and compare the love of Allah to the love of people. Because we love each other. I mean, we have love in our hearts. Love to our parents, to our families, to our friends, to our spouses, you know, to, you know, people that are close to us. Love does exist. You know, we're not void of love. There is love in our hearts. We are capable of loving, right? But when you love people, I want you to compare loving people versus loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you love people, the flame of love may fade over time. Isn't that true? The flame of love, you know, people move out of town, they have disagreements, you know, they just don't like each other anymore. No matter how close you were to a friend, and you say, this is my best friend, I love my friend so much, one day, that love may fade and may get weaker and weaker over time until it just goes away and disappears. But the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a flame that continues to kindle forever. At least I know that Allah azza wa jal will always love me, right? Subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we love people and you express your love a little too much and you make requests and demands, people will think that you're what? They'll think you're needy. This is a very needy person. But when we love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the hadith, in Allah azza wa jalla yuhibbu al-abda al-lahuh, Allah loves His worshippers that are nagging, constantly nagging, Lord, I want this, Lord, I want this, Lord, I want that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be needy, and He wants you to be nagging all the time, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our love for people, brothers and sisters, needs reciprocity. When people love us, they want us to love them back. When people, you know, greet us, they want us to greet them. When people attend our events, they want us to attend their events. It's got to be reciprocity. But you can abandon the path of Allah your entire life. And you come into the month of Ramadan and you say, Ya Allah, I am ready now to get closer to you. You'll find that His arms are always wide open. And He will embrace you in a second. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He is al-azim. He is the most sublime and the greatest, but it's almost like Allah is on standby waiting for you to make a gesture. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. People will always disappoint you, right? You love people, but they will fall short. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never fall short. In fact, He will always, always exceed your expectations, okay? It is easy for us to say, you know, in Ramadan, you guys need to read at least two or three pages of the Quran every day, and you need to make this dua, and you need to make that dhikr, and you need to refrain from this, and you need to deprive yourself of that, and you need actions, 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 right? It is easy to create a list of actions, but it is not easy to go through the exercise of the heart and ask yourself, how am I connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? How am I connected with Allah? You know, when you go and perform Umrah, and then you come back and you are in that state of mind on your way back home where you're such, I mean, I was just there like a couple hours ago. You are literally at the airport in Medina, flying out, and all you want to do is what? Go back, right? Do you know that feeling? If you've ever had that feeling before? At the end of Ramadan, when you are coming to Salatul Taraweeh, and it was a tough month, and you struggled, and you were hungry, and thirsty, and sleep deprived, right? But when you pray Salatul Taraweeh the very last night on Ramadan, you are so emotional, and you are crying. Why? Because the blessings of Ramadan are about to end. And I was, you know, I was becoming so tight with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now it's going to be all over and I need to go on the rest of the year without Ramadan. And I need to acclimate myself to connecting with Allah Azza wa Jal without Ramadan, right? That's a mental exercise. It's a spiritual exercise and it's a lot more difficult, but tremendously more rewarding than the actions of the flesh. Don't be deluded by the actions of the flesh and forget about the actions of the heart that are the primary purpose for which we designed the actions of the flesh. Does that make sense? The actions of the flesh and the physical activities of worship in Ramadan are designed to help you develop some sense of connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the month of Ramadan. And I ask Allah on this day to bless you and give you the illumination and the enlightenment of seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your hearts and witnessing the growth of that relationship and that love in your hearts. Allahumma ameen. Brothers and sisters, raise your hands and speak to Allah Azza wa Jal from the heart. أدعو الله وأنتم موقنون بالإجابة. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وقائد الغر الميامين محمد الصادق الوعد الأمين. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وارض عنا معهم بفضلك وكرمك أرحم الراحمين اللهم آمين. My dear brothers and sisters, on the second Friday of the month of Ramadan, and now that 10 days of the month are already over, I wanted to remind you and remind myself that the greatest gift, the greatest blessing, and the greatest reward of the month of Ramadan is to take advantage of the month to build a renewed sense of love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in your hearts. And this is the love that will become your shield. It's the love that will become your guidance. It's the love that will become your torch of light. It's the love that will become your weapon facing the challenges of life. No matter what is happening to you or what you're going through, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will get you through it. Because it'll give you that firm sense of grounding in your life as a human being. And I said that while there is so much to achieve in Ramadan, I feel that the greatest virtue and the greatest gift that you can ever achieve in Ramadan is to build your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through this month. As the Prophet taught us, love Allah for the abundance of His blessings and love me for loving Him and love my family for loving me. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallim. This month, In our Khatira series during Salatul Taraweeh, we focused on the legacy of the Tabi'een, the generation of Muslims that studied the deen from the companions of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you know, those of you, and I urge you, if you haven't been coming to Salatul Taraweeh, you know, please do come. And if you don't live close by, at least go to the masjid that is closer to your house. But you have to come to the masjid, you know, as frequently as possible to be with your brothers and sisters, to pray and to make dua, and to listen to a talk that can be of benefit to you, to rejuvenate your heart. And we're talking about the Tabi'een and that generation of great men and women that surrounded the companions of the Prophet ﷺ. And every night we take a quality of the Tabi'een and we talk about that quality and how it helped them build their own civilization and how it can help us, that quality, how it can help us build a healthy community right here and now. We talked about so many tabi'een so far, and I did not want to break away from the trend during Khutbatul Jum'ah. So I wanted to also talk about one of the tabi'een today. A tabi'i that was known to be overflowing with love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his heart. And, you know, this great tabi'i was, you know, as many of the tabi'een were, from Iraq, from the great city of Basra. His name is Amir ibn Abdullah al-Ambari. Amir ibn Abdullah al-Ambari. What a beautiful name. Ambari. You know, Ambar, Ambar, this, you know, beautiful fragrance. His name is Amir ibn Abdullah al-Ambari. And he was traveling on this caravan. And when the caravan came to a halt, came to a stop, he got on his horse and he galloped away. And a young man from Basra was there and he knew that, you know, Amir ibn Abdullah is a great scholar. So he wanted to follow him in order to see what he's doing in the middle of the night. Everyone went to sleep And you know, the tabi'i Amir got on his horse and basically galloped away with the horse. So he followed him until he saw him tie his horse to a tree, you know, next to this massive forest, and left some food with the horse, meaning that he was planning to leave the horse a while. And he walked literally in the dark into the forest, you know, with only the moon as a source of light. So he followed him until, you know, Amir ibn Abdullah arrived at this plateau, and he stood there and he started making dhikr first to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this, you know, a man from Basra heard Amir ibn Abdullah say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma inni ahbabtuka hubban khaffafa alayya kulla musibatin wa raddani bi kulli qada. Lord, I have loved you in a way that made any trial so light in my eyes, eased on me any trial, and gave me content with your qada, with your choices in my life, right? Allahumma inni ahbabtuka hubban khaffafa alayya kulla musibatin wa raddani bi kulli qada. Wa wallahi ya rabbi bi hubbika la ubali fi ayyi halin asbaht wa ala ayyi halin amsayt. As long as I enjoy your love in my heart, Lord, I don't really care and I don't mind in which state I find myself when I wake up in the morning and in which state I find myself when I go to sleep at night. It doesn't matter to me anymore because your love is what fills my heart. And this man from Basra is just, you know, mesmerized observing the Imam and taking it all in. And then, you know, he would basically, you know, go to sleep and wake up and go to sleep and wake up, you know, doze on and off, basically, watching the Imam pray. So the Imam continued to pray throughout the night. And then it was Fajr time, so the Imam prayed, Salatul Fajr. And after Fajr, he started making dua. Allahumma inni sa'altuka thalatha fa'azaytani thnatayn wa man'atani wahida. Lord, I asked you three things and you granted me two, and you refrain from giving me the third that I asked for. Allahumma fa'atini iyyaha. Lord, grant me my third request. I have been asking you for the longest time to grant me three things, and you granted three, and you did not grant me the third. Please grant me the third. So the man from Basra ruffled the branches a little bit and made some noise, and the Imam detected his presence. So he was really startled. And he said, ya akhal Basra, my brother from Basra, you know, what are you doing here? You know, please, whatever that you saw me do, keep it between us. Don't disgrace me. Don't talk to people about what I've done. I want to keep this between me and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he says, Imam, I grant you that, but you have to tell me about the three things that you asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for. So the Imam told him, the three things that I requested, two were granted and one was denied. سألت الله عز وجل ألا أخاف أحدا غيره. I requested from Allah that I have no fear in my heart from anyone on this earth except Him, and that was granted. وسألت الله وما كنت أخاف على وكان أخوف ما أخاف فيه على ديني من شهوة النساء. And I was always so worried in my heart that sexual desire might corrupt me. So I asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove that from my heart so it doesn't control me anymore, and that was granted. وَسَأَلْتُ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ أَلَّا أَنَامُ حَتَّى أَعْبُدُهُ كَمَا أَشَاءُ صَبَاحًا وَمَسَاءً. I requested from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I don't need to sleep anymore so that I can worship Him day and night as I please and as I wish. Allah granted two, and He would not grant me the third. I still get sleepy and I fall asleep and I can't. Right? So the man from Basra asked Amir ibn Abdullah to make dua for him, you know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would grant him yaqadha, would grant him heedfulness of Allah azza wa jal in his life, and he went away. And in the month of Ramadan, the month in which we talk about the tabi'een, I want you to be inspired by the story of Amir ibn Abdullah al-Ambari radiallahu anhu, a man who was known in our history books to be a man whose heart overflew with a love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And perhaps this love will change your life. Perhaps your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will change your perspective, will bring you close. All the effort that you're trying to put to avoid sinful behavior or to acquire good habits, perhaps it can all happen easily if you have the love of Allah azza wa jal in your heart with the blessings of this month of Ramadan. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this day to grant us our wishes and to answer our prayers and to accept our good deeds in this month of Ramadan. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our fasting as imperfect as it is, to accept our prayers as imperfect as they are. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us cleanse our hearts, to help us surrender ourselves to Him in humility and love. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this day to grant us the greatest gift in this universe, and that is to be in love with Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we've loved You, Ya Allah, in this world, I ask You to make us among those who enter Jannah in the company of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and those will be able to see Your face, and those will be able to be rewarded by Your company and Your love in Jannah. Allahumma ameen. Ya Allah, we ask You to be there for our brothers and sisters that struggle all over the world, that struggle with poverty, that struggle with homelessness, that struggle with injustice or tyranny. Ya Allah, we ask You to make us aids for them and to make us catalysts of change in their lives and to help us help them. And Ya Allah, we ask You to give us gratitude for the blessings that we enjoy right here at home. Ya Allah, we ask You to make us among those who show their gratitude in words and action. Ya Allah, we ask You not to take those blessings away from us, but to enable us to be grateful. Ya Allah, we ask You to strengthen our brotherhood and sisterhood, and to bring us closer to each other as members of the same community, and to show us beautiful days of prosperity ahead. Ya Allah, as You have granted our wishes and gave us a chance to experience Ramadan of this year, we ask You to give us the chance to experience so many Ramadans to come, and to be blessed and forgiven in all of them, Ya Rabbil Alameen. And as You've gathered us here in this shape and form, Ya Allah, we ask You to gather all of us in Your Jannah on the Day of Judgment. Allahumma Ameen.